This is going to be part 10 of the series of tutorials for creating our workout app. And I believe that by the end of step 9, we have completed, part 9, we completed step number 71, which gives us two lights on either side of the racket. So we can see it even in the dark. It kind of illuminates itself. Now that we are, our racket is almost done, and as you will see, in 73, we're going to add something to it, but since it's almost done, we can duplicate it. I don't want to turn it into a prefab because there's going to be some significant differences, as you will see, between the left and the right in tags. So it's not worth, you know, creating a prefab just for two instances that are different from each other anyway. But I'm definitely going to take my racket, right click and duplicate it, and drag the duplicate to the right-hand anchor. So now the right-hand anchor has a racket, and there's two rackets. Let's even give them names. My racket L and my racket R. Now they are identical in every way. They're even symmetrical. There's no need to, like, you know, turn them around or anything. They look exactly the same. But what I am going to do to them is I'm going to go back to my racket on the left hand. This is a good thing why I gave it a name. And unfold it and create a tag. Let's bring this in so we can read it. Create a tag called LRAC, capital LRAC, exact, and give it to the ring and the net. In other words, I want to be able to detect if one of the flying objects is hit either the ring or the net of the left rack. Why is it important to differentiate between the hands? If only for one thing, to make sure that only the left one, the left controller vibrates. So that's how it's going to know that it's a left one that captured one of the flying objects. So I'm going to unfold. I'm going to select my ring. Right now it's untagged. And I'm going to add tag plus call it LRAC exact. Yep. And I'm going to go back to the ring and give it LRAC, also to the net. In other words, I can catch one of those flying objects either by hitting the ring or the net. That's fine. Give it to the ring and the net, we just did. Repeat the last step on the ring and the net of my racket on the left hand, but this time a tag called R. Rack exact. So, right racket, my ring, new tag, which is going to be added, called R rack. Only the first R will be capitalized. Once I got that, I'm going to give it to the ring of the left hand and the net of the left hand. Not the handle, not the point lights, or any of that. Now our rackets are really finished. And that completes number 74. We're going to create an empty game object called music and add an audio source with a clip BG music, play on awake, loop, and bypass reverb zones. In other words, typical background music. Empty. Game object, I'm going to reset its transform, although it's not that important. Call it music. I'm going to add an audio component, audio source component, which is going to be played on awake and looped, and its clip is going to be BG music, which came from the teacher's assets. Nice, you know, workout music. And bypass reverb zones, because there's going to be a reverb zone. We might have one for the click, for the impact sound of catching the balls, but I don't want that to affect the music. So bypass reverb zones. I don't want to add any reverb to it, even if there is a reverb zone nearby. And final little touches, create an empty game object called App Manager. We've done this before. We're going to create a script to it. If I might as well copy, I might as well copy that exact name. For right now, just a shell, and to the App Manager, add an audio reverb zone. Preset, concert hall. So, new empty object. App Manager, might as well put it at the top because that's where I like to see it, although it does not matter. It's reset its transform. Add two things to it. Let's start with a reverb zone. And the preset we said was going to be concert hall. And because it's pretty much where I am, it's going to reverberate everything around it, any sounds, unless they were told to avoid reverb zones, like the music. And one more thing, that script called App Manager, create an add for right now, just an empty shell. And of course, I know that when I create empty scripts, they get added at the top of the assets folder. I'm going to move it into my scripts. What should we have so far in the folder, my scripts? Let's see. We should have the script we just created, App Manager, the Catch Me script, which is attached to all the flying objects, the intro script, which takes us from intro to loading, the loading script, which takes us from loading to the game, and the wall script, which is attached to the wall behind us, which is for catching balls, flying objects that were not caught by one of the rackets, which means we are just done with step number 77. Let's continue. It's not too much work to do the work endgame. Now, as we are going to program it, there's going to be, let's say, 50 flying objects, whether you catch them or not. And once those 50 have flown, the game is over and it shows you, oh, you caught like half of them, you caught, you know, 75% of them and so on. Where you see that is the scene called Endgame. Now, Endgame is going to be more of a display than anything else. Therefore, we can duplicate the workout intro and call it Workout Endgame Exact. Why, of course? Because that name will appear in the script when we go to and from that scene. So, I'm going to find the scene called Workout Intro, duplicate it. Instead of Workout Intro 1, call it Workout, missing a W here, capital W, Workout End Game, and open it. Just like the intro scene, it'll have some static text and some updated numbers. What are we going to do to it? We duplicated, we changed the name of the intro manager to Endgame Manager and remove the intro script. It's not intro manager, it's Endgame Manager. But because of that, we don't want it to have the intro script, remove. We want it to have a brand new script, which I want to call Endgame script. The main job of the Endgame script is going to show the Endgame results, but also enable you to go and restart the game. So Endgame Manager, add component, new script, Endgame script, create an add and move it into the scripts folder. Just make sure it's named correctly. Endgame script with a lowercase g, is that the way it should be? Yep, it is. And we just did step number 79. Now the UI is going to be a little different. It doesn't need a picture. here. So in the UI, we can delete the quad, which is really like, you know, this sign. Right click, delete. In the canvas, you don't need this V. In the canvas, change the text of the instruction one to something like, good job, game over. Remember, we get instruction one and two. So instruction one, instead of giving instructions to catch the flying objects, I'm just going to say game over. Good job, whatever. Change the text of instruction two to something, if an instruction to play again, press the trigger on both controllers. So it's actually a very small change. It almost already says that instead of to start, we're going to say, change the word to start to replay. Replay, play again, whatever words make more sense to you. To replay, press the OK. Instruction 3 and best score num can stay where they are because we want to tell users that their your best all-time score is whatever, and then the actual number. Duplicate both and call the dupes instruction 4 and current score num. So instead of best score num, current score num. So I'm going to take both of those. Right click or just go to edit and duplicate, and instead of instruction 3 duplicate, it's going to be called instruction 4, and instead of best score num with a number, it's going to be called current score num. So in other words, as soon as they finish the game, they'll be able to see their best score ever of all time, but and how they did this time around. And I think you're guessing that the next thing I'm going to do is select both my dupes and simply move them down. So that way I have instruction 3 and the best score, instruction 4 and the current score. And the only thing I'm going to change in instruction 4 is the text instead of best. It's this time around. In instruction 4, the text is going to be so your best overall score is, let's say, 30%, and in this round, your overall score was 20%, whatever it ends up being. Move their Y under the existing text, so we already did that. Change the text of instruction 4, we already did that. So now scene and game view should look something like this, and they do, especially the scene. Game over, good job. To replay, do this. Your best score is that. And your current score is this. You can play around, of course, with sizes and fonts and, you know, and alignment and so on, as long as that information is there. To finish the end game scene, we're going to create, because we already have a manager with a script, is some kind of a sound. So we're going to create an empty game object called end sound, just like we had the music on the main game. End game sound. The only thing this needs other than to be reset is an audio source and the clip, which already came with the assets that you copied, is called end game sound, some kind of like a nice ta-da. Play on awake. Uncheck loop. We don't want it to loop. We just want it to play once, like a, you know, like a end sound. In the teacher assets, in the sounds, just want to play it for you. The end game sound is this. When we go from the game to the end game, it's going to stop the music and instead play that sound. Which brings us to the end of step number 84, and in the next tutorial, finally, we're going to start populating the scripts with code. So I can mark all of that done. And I will see you in the next tutorial, which will be number 11.